going on.
The story of
of a journey propelled by love. The love of a mighty God and the people he had created. It's the story of perfection that was destroyed, of mercy that was extended, and of God's faithfulness through it all. Despite humanity's rebellion and disobedience, God's plan to set things right kept unfolding. There were times the Almighty's voice thundered with judgment. Sometimes it was a song of comfort. For 400 years, he was simply silent. Then one night in the town of Bethlehem, everything changed. As a boy, Jesus roamed the hills of Nazareth. At 12, he stood in the temple and spoke of tending to his father's business. At 30, he was baptized as John proclaimed him the Lamb of God. Then for 3 years, he traveled throughout the land, healing the sick, delivering the broken, loving the outcast, and even raising the dead. At last, the road turned again to Jerusalem. As he rode into the city, crowds greeted him the way they would greet a conquering king. Jesus knew what was waiting ahead as the journey that had taken thousands of years descended into deep shadows. Powerful religious and political forces aligned to destroy him. One who had posed as a faithful follower betrayed him for the price of a slave. But first the Lord would eat the Passover meal with his friends. He had one more opportunity to show them his love and prepare them for the coming day. In Gethsemane, Jesus prayed alone. The first drops of blood that he would shed on our behalf trickled down his brow as he surrendered to his Father's will. Soldiers arrived to arrest him, and the long night of trial and torture began. Sentenced to death by crucifixion. He was stripped and scourged and mocked. And then he carried his own cross up the hill of Golgotha, where he opened his arms, submitted to the nails in his hands and feet, and laid down his life willingly in your place and mine.
Crucify my Lord, oh, 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 oh,
outside that day, the message Jesus had come to deliver was unmistakable. God loved us so much, he would do whatever it took to save us.
In letters of crimson, God wrote his love on a hillside so long, long ago. For you and for me, Jesus.
Just when it looked like the story of Jesus would end in defeat, heaven revealed a new chapter called Victory. Sometime before the third day dawned, within the tomb, his heart began to beat. His lungs filled with air. Jesus rose to life again, just as he said he would. And the sorrow of the cross turned into joy. Jesus conquered death, the praise that had always surrounded him in heaven suddenly became the song that his followers took up on earth. He alone was holy. He alone could save us. When we needed a lamb to atone for our sins, he alone could do it.
Do you feel the world is broken? Do you feel the shadows deep? But do you know that all the dark stop the light from getting through? Do you wish that we could see it all made new? Is all creation groaning? Is a new creation coming? Is the glory of the Lord to be light within our midst? Is it good that we remind ourselves of God? Is anyone worthy? Is anyone whole? Is anyone able to break the seal and open the scroll? The Lion of Judah, who conquered the grave, he is David's root and the Lamb who died to ransom the slain. Is he worthy? Is he worthy of all blessing and honor and glory? Is he worthy of praise? Does the Father truly love us?
He does.
Does the Spirit move among us? And does Jesus, our Messiah, hold forever those he loves?
He does.
Does our God intend to dwell again with us?
He does.
Is anyone worthy? Is anyone called? Is anyone able to break the seal and open the scroll? The Lion of Judah, who conquered the grave, he is David's root and the Lamb who died to ransom the slain. From every people and tribe, every nation and tongue, he has made us a kingdom and priest to God. With the Son. Is he worthy? Is he worthy of all blessing and honor and glory? Is he worthy? Is he worthy? Is he worthy of?
Thousands upon thousands, and 10,000 times 10,000. They encircled the throne, and the living creatures, and the elders. In a loud voice they were saying, "Worthy is the Lamb who was slain, to receive power, and wealth, and wisdom, and strength, and honor, and glory, and praise."
Filled with
Once we realize how Jesus has been the answer to every need we have, we want to tell him again and again that he is more than we imagined he could be. And we want to tell the world they will never find anyone who is like our Lord.
Worthy of every song we could ever sing. Worthy of all the praise we could ever bring. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe, we live for you. Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever save. Worthy of every
Is anyone home? Is anyone able to break the seal and open the scroll? The Lion of Judah, who conquered the grave, he is David's fruit and the Lamb who died in the hands of the slave. From every people and tribe, every nation and tongue, he has made us a kingdom and priest to God to reign with the sun. Is he worthy? Is he worthy of all blessing and honor and glory? Is he worthy? Is he worthy? Is he worthy?
Good to be together with a choir and to have a choir again and have a few more people in the congregation. We're still not up to our regular numbers. In fact, I don't even know how many, if there's some maybe in the parking lot or not. But anyway, it's good to be in the Lord's house and looking forward to enjoying a meal. And, you know, that comes this time of year when we share the cantata, and then I get to share a real short sermon with you, and everybody laughs about my short sermon, but I have been able to do it from time to time, a short sermon. And you'll notice in the Revelation chapter 4, and to go right along with the theme of the cantata, is worthy is the Lamb. Is he worthy? And of course he is, and it's talks about it in the Word of God here in Revelation chapter 4, starting at verse 9. And you're going to see some repetition here because it's for emphasis' sake. In fact, I was in a meeting way up in Easley, South Carolina, way up in the mountains one day, and it was a foggy morning, and we had gone up through the mountains, and we came to this meeting. And they warned us when we got there. They said, the people won't get in a hurry to come, these mountain folks, and they won't get in a hurry to leave either. Amen? And so they had a saying up in the mountains. They said, let's go to meeting. And so they believed in that. And I never will forget, Brother Rainwater preached about how that the angels would say, holy, 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 and that in that crowded little auditorium there, up in the mountains, the Smoky Mountains, he divided the church right down in half like this one is. And he says, all right, you people on this side, you say holy. And then he said, you people on this side, you say holy. And he had great big old hands, enormous hands. And so he was down here in the aisle, and he put out his hand over here, and this group said holy. And then the next group answered, and they said holy. And then the next group answered, and they said, holy. And I tell you what, I thought I was in heaven right then. Amen. It was amazing. So here's the scripture real quickly. Whenever the living creatures, that's us too, amen, we're living creatures. Whenever the living creatures give glory and honor and thanks to him who sits on the throne, who lives forever and ever, the 24 elders fall down before him who sits on the throne, and they worship him who lives forever and ever. And they cast their crowns before the throne, saying, you are worthy, O Lord, to receive glory and honor and power. That's what we just sang. For you created all things, and by your will they exist and were created. Now, there's three things that I want you to note this morning about the resurrected Christ. There are many, many other things, but just for just a few moments this morning, three things. And that's, first of all, in talking about the Lord being worthy of worship, we find our wonder. We wonder in amazement at God's, what God has done. And we stand at this time of year amazed at God's creation. Just a few weeks ago, I was looking out my front yard, and I said, you know, I think my azalea bushes are dead. They look dead. They're brown. There's no life in them. The freeze got them. They're dead. But there is a resurrection. Amen. The azaleas have never looked any more full, more beautiful than they do right now. Amen. And it's amazing. As in springtime, we marvel at how something comes back to life again. And now we find also there's nothing that can compare to what our Savior did when He raised from the dead and He showed us His great power, not only over death and hell, but also He showed us how to live in the resurrected life that He provides for us. And so we have this great power of God that's available to us living on the inside. Now, when I was about 12 years old, in fact, I was 12 years old, when the World's Fair came to San Antonio. Amen? Y'all remember that? Came to San Antonio? That was in 1968. I was 12 years old. It's called Hemisphere 68. How many of y'all went to that? Amen? I did. Several, okay? I went to that. And listen, when I was growing up, we didn't travel hardly ever. I had gone to downtown Houston at Christmas time, and that's about the extent of my travels, amen? We hadn't traveled hardly any at all, hadn't seen anything, and so as a 12-year-old boy, we went to the Hemisphere, and I thought, man, this is something neat. And they had all these different displays and different things going on, and the big Space Needle going up, and you know, it's a restaurant now. And we like to go up there every once in a while and have a meal. And that thing circles around. It takes it an hour. It's like a clock. It takes it an hour to go around in one circle. And it's a restaurant, pretty decent food too, by the way. But listen, I remember we went up in the needle and we saw different displays. I remember the science display just was amazing to me. But what I really liked more than anything was the futuristic cars. Amen. They had a whole a room full of cars that were prototypes that were for futuristic kind of cars. And of course, we would say they were kind of funky looking now. But back then, it was kind of neat looking at these things. But listen, as marvelous as that was, that was not even a fraction of what it is to know and wonder at the Lord Jesus and His great power, His glory. And so we have wonder. The second thing I want to talk about the resurrected Christ is worship. And that's what we talked to and sang a lot about this morning too. Worship is basic to the human experience because we're created to worship. In fact, whether you even believe in God or not, you're going to worship something. You're going to worship something or someone or some kind of concept or something. You're going to worship something because that's how we're created. We're created to worship. And in the Bible, worship is associated with sacrifice. And so when we understand the sacrifice of Christ, then that causes us to really understand the worship and what it means. And the Bible forbids us from bowing down or worshiping any other thing except the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, worship of God is to be public, but it's also to be private as well. And as believers in Christ, I want to encourage you, if you know Christ and have a personal relationship with Him, you're going to have a time to where you worship the Lord, amen? In your home, as maybe music, it may be a time when you are reading the scriptures, and or whatever the case may be, you're going to be thanking God and worshiping Him. And then also the activity of worship will continue throughout eternity. Now, this is what I like. Amen? Just think about it. You come to church and you have just a few minutes, you know, of maybe some singing. It might be good. It might be bad. Whatever it is. Amen? But listen, then you might have a sermon, and it might be good. It might be bad. You just never know. And so the sermon may not be all that good, but listen, if we meet with the Lord, that's the important thing. And when we worship Him, we're partaking in an activity, in an experience that we will, if you know the Lord, you will experience that throughout all of eternity. And so it's actually bringing a little bit of eternity here and now at this time, the time of worship and praise to the Savior. And so I believe in eternity. You say, well, preacher, won't we ever get tired of doing some of these things? I don't think so. And I just have a little theory that I've shared with you from time to time, and that is, I believe that it will take all of eternity, because God is an eternal being. And I believe it will take all of eternity for God to reveal His greatness, His power, His purpose, His plan, all these marvelous things. I believe that it will take all of eternity. You ever watch the program to where they take the ocean and they like drain the ocean? They don't really drain it, obviously. But they drain the ocean and they show you what's beneath the surface. And I can just imagine that God is going to take, and throughout all of eternity, He's going to say, you know that star that you saw up in the sky? Let me show you what that star is all about. Let me show you beneath the surface. Let me show you some things about that. And I believe, and the Bible tells us that the stars give glory to God. And I believe we'll see some aspect of God's glory that we never knew before. That God will always be revealing Himself throughout all of eternity, and it will take all that time as we worship the Savior. So there's wonder and there's worship, but notice lastly there is watching. We're always anticipating, and God has built that into also our human experience. When we're going on maybe a trip or vacation or something else or whatever it may be, you may be just anticipating a nice meal like I am right there. I saw some of that chocolate back there, amen. And so make sure you save me some. But listen, we anticipate. We're watching in anticipation of some of these things. And in our Christian faith, we anticipate the Lord's coming. We anticipate Him and the glory that will be revealed. We also, as we get older, we anticipate the fact that we won't have all these aches and pains and problems and sorrows any longer. Amen? And that's something to look forward to. And so we understand this earthly life is not all there is. And we anticipate the Lord's coming. And the Bible says, and so shall we ever be with the Lord. And so the Lord is worthy. We wonder, we worship, and we're watching. The Lord is worthy of our adoration, our attention. He's worthy of our gifts and also our sacrifice. He sacrificed for us. We can sacrifice some things for Him. He's worthy of our trust. You can put your trust in the Lord Jesus Christ. In fact, that's one of the definitions or descriptions of believe in the Bible. In the book of John, the theme of the Gospel of John is believe. It's a kind of a key word, and always comes back to this thing of believing. And that word believe, in the Greek language, carries with it a whole host of understanding that when you believe in God, you trust in Him. You put yourself into Him. You become in a relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ, and you believe in Him. It's not just believing about Him. It's trusting in the Lord. He's worthy of all of our trust. And would you put your trust in the Lord today? Would you stand with us this morning? I think we'll have a song of invitation. And today would be a good day to trust in the Lord. Amen. Today is a great day to know the Lord Jesus Christ as your personal Savior. While we sing this morning, what number?
I'm changing it. 317.
317. 317. As we sing together, trust in Him as we sing.
Wait a minute, Carol's got to get there. I changed it.
Come every soul by sin oppressed, there's mercy with the Lord, and He will surely give you rest by trusting in His word. Only trust Him, only trust Him, only trust Him now. He will save you, He will save you, He will save you now.
Amen. Thank you so much. I appreciate your attendance with us, and feel free to stay with us and eat a bite. And even if you want to distance a little bit, there's plenty of overflow rooms. And believe me, there's plenty of room for all of us back there. Let's just do that and enjoy the good blessing of a good meal. Amen.
Cliff, can I say one thing?
Yes.
I just want to thank the choir. Thank
you. Amen. Thank you, choir. Amen. Amen. I want to thank the choir, but I want to thank the Lord. Amen. It's just good. It's just good to have a choir again and get to meet together and eat again. And I was going to mention, a little birdie told me that Wilma Anderson has a birthday tomorrow. Amen.
Tuesday.
Okay. Tuesday. All right. And so if you can, tell her happy birthday, embarrass her some or whatever.
Doesn't take much.
Amen. All right. Well, God bless you. It's good to be in the Lord's house. And good to have Brandon with us. Brandon, I'm going to ask if you would to take this microphone and dismiss us in prayer, please, sir.
And bless the food, please.
And bless the food. Ask a blessing upon the food as well.
My goodness. God, thank you for this day, Lord. Thank you for the blessings you have poured out upon us. And, Lord, just continue to watch over us and guide us as we go out to do your will, Lord, to serve you in our community and everywhere we pass, Lord. Lord, thank you for this food that was provided for us today, Lord. Thank you, the hands that prepared it, Lord. And just continue to watch over us. In your name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
No choir
Well, we did all right.